That's part of the scripture. Feel welcome. I'm Edward Gobrecht, Pastor Emeritus. And I'm wearing this instead of my usual one. This your pastor is attending General Synod today, even as we speak. There's a lot of work in Indianapolis, I believe they are.
Yeah.
And when I was there, the North Dakota people gave this out. You can tell it reflects their heritage. And they gave one out. But it's red, white, and blue also, but it has that American, Native American look to it. So I thought I'd wear that today. We have a whole lots of announcements. Do you have some announcements you'd like to share today? Anybody? There's a whole desk in there. Everybody knows what's going on, and there's all kinds of inserts today, partly due to the guest pastor. All right, somewhere. Well, then they're going to share with me in the call to worship then. How clearly the sky reveals God's glory.
How plainly it shows what he has done.
Each day announces it to the following day.
Each night repeats it to the next.
Their message goes out to all the world.
And is heard to the ends of the earth. Were like sheep that were lost,
each of us going his own way.
His death was a sacrifice to bring forgiveness.
He took the place of many sinners.
He prayed that they might be forgiven.
Mercy is great, O Lord. Your love abounds us. God, hears the confessions of our hearts and our lips. Through Jesus Christ, we are forgiven our sins, and by the Holy Spirit, we are empowered for new life. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen.
Just a closer walk with thee.
most important book the Apostle Paul wrote. It's not something to sit down and say, I think I'll go read the book of Romans today. But very thoughtful treatise which the Apostle wrote for us under the inspiration of the Spirit. So Romans 6, starting at the 12th verse. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal bodies to make you obey their passions. Do not yield your members to sin as instruments of wickedness, but yield yourself to God as people who have been brought from death to life, and your members to God as instruments of righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. What then? Are we to sin because we are not under law, but under grace? By no means. Do you not know that if you yield yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness. But thanks be to God that you who were once slaves of sin have become obedient from the heart to the standard of teaching to which you were committed, and having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. I'm speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations. But just as you once yielded your members to impurity and to greater and greater impurity, so now you yield your members to righteousness for sanctification. When you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. But then what return did you get from the things of which you are now ashamed? The end of these things is death. But now you've been set free from sin and have become slaves of God. The return you get is sanctification, and its end, eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Thank you as we follow along with that. Our gospel lesson is on your bulletin before you. From Matthew, the 10th chapter, sort of right in the middle of the speech that Jesus has given. Anyone who welcomes me, and anyone who welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet as a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever welcomes a righteous person as a righteous person will receive a righteous person's reward. And if anyone gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones who is my disciple, truly I tell you, that person will certainly not lose their reward. This is the good news.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Right, I'm going to go to our new speaker this morning and share a little patriotic medley. So I'll listen to all those good sounds coming up.
Of the sweet land of liberty.
righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people.
Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord.
Since it's 4th of July, it's a national holiday, so I make a political statement, such as, I'm in favor of democracy. I think I can get away with that one, don't I? And I get a lot of support with that also, and I'm sure you get mail, I get mail that says, from one political party says, we've got to protect our democracy, and they list things, one, two, three, and sounds pretty good, I'll go along with that. The next day I got one from someone else that says, we're going to work to save our democracy, and they list one, two, three, I think, well, that sounds pretty good, but they're not together, they're going all these different ways. How are you going to protect your democracy if you don't know what's the best statement? That's kind of a tough area to go work with. And I think to say, people really make me sound bad in our society, they say, our nation has never been as divided as it is now. We're living in Gettysburg, we think that's a little extreme. Things are probably a lot more divided in 1861, 2 than they are now, really. The word gets out a little faster now, but that's the kind of area we have. There certainly is, there's a point to say, there's no division, no anger, but there's also a lot of good things together. And I was thinking, usually at Thanksgiving, we hear a nice sermon about we all get together, all the people, the Native Americans and the Pilgrims, and thank God for the blessings and that they can work together. But even then, our nation had Puritans and Native Americans and Anabaptists and Roman Catholics and all those different groups, people who didn't care for God at all, and they were all living in the same place too. It's just that we were more spread out, and as they say, communication wasn't quite as fast as it is now. So that's kind of that picture which we have. And I'd like to come to church and say, well, you know, I'm going to say we look to God first of all, and so we would. But even if you're looking at the scriptures, if I had backed up the gospel reading this morning, the gospel, Jesus says, I've not come to bring peace, but a sword. We think that's strange for Jesus and families, so we'll be against one another. So that even with the gospel, tends to pull people apart sometimes. We know that happens. And then also Jesus talks about, I've not come to bring peace, but a sword. We think, we never have that picture. We never see Jesus with a sword in Scripture. Peter has one when they go to arrest Jesus, and Jesus says, put up your sword. There's a beautiful picture in the book of Revelation where that vision is that he's seeing the Messiah, this figure as bright as the day's sun. In his right hand are seven stars representing, we think, the churches that are there. And from his mouth, a two-edged sword, sharper than anything. And I think of that picture of him in Hebrews talks about the word of God is like a two-edged sword, cutting the bone and marrow and opening the desires of everybody's heart and mind, which tells you that's a beautiful and kind of frightening picture at the same time. So we put that sword on our side, I guess, and to be on that picture. So there's that division which is there and the struggle. So we're going to follow Jesus, but it's not all that easy. I can say the straight and the narrow, I added up the uphill sometimes too. It's not always easy following that word. And we get ourselves pulled back and forth as Paul was doing in Romans. We're either going to be a slave to sin or to righteousness. That kind of that picture. And that opening picture which is there, maybe changes to slaves to servants, whatever, but that picture which is there of modern groups will talk about addiction. We think of all the addictions we hear about, being addicted to sin, if you will, and being drawn away from God. But that opening picture is that you can follow God's word indeed, and then you become a servant of God. You're free to serve God. That's a beautiful, it's a great exchange. And that's the picture which is there. To say it's not always easy, I was watching Major League Baseball, and when the ones you got pretty well ahead, they sent him a new pitcher. He'd never pitched at a Major League game before. But what the feeling would be. And the first one, he struck out the first batter. Oh, terrific. And after that, things went to pieces. People started hitting anything. His backup, his team wasn't helping. They were out there dropping the ball. The score started mounting. And he got pulled out of his very first game after about an inning and a half. I think he's going to be called up again sometime. Is he going to say, I can't finish. Oh, it's going to be that bad. Or you get out and try it again. And that's kind of the picture, I think, with Christians sometimes. You think, oh, I'm not doing much of anything. I can't do it. I'm tired. I can follow that with my baseball team. But if you're on the team, and if you watch the news, just a quick thing, they always show little bits of the weather and a couple minutes of the sports. I'll show you somebody hits a home run. And it's true, they do. But if you watch the whole game, they might strike out. They might drop the ball. They might get hit by the ball, as far as that goes. It goes on. It gets tiresome. You're behind, and it's sixth inning, and you got to stay overnight. Other people are leaving, and you got to stay there and finish because you're on that team. And the next thing is, you know, you have to go the next day and come back and do it again. And I just thought of that sometimes with our faith. We say, I'm no good. I can't handle it. But every now and then we hit a home run. And that's kind of the picture. That's kind of that encouragement which is there. We're going to be free to serve our God, and we have a very generous God to work with. So that's kind of the call which I have set us before us this day. And the part that gets to me now is then God expects us to not only to follow, to try our best. Now we're getting to be generous on top of it. Usually when you say generous in church, people say, oh, they're going to take up an offering. This is being generous in spirit. And it's really hard to do that in our society when people are arguing and they're hearing such hateful things back and forth, and people say, I'm going to get what I want and get out of here, and that kind of thing. And the Christian's supposed to say, welcome, and well, things are okay. And if you try to do something nice, you kind of expect a thank you. That's part of my children's thing. We expect a thank you somehow. It doesn't happen. And you do something else, and people take advantage of that. And I'm not going to do any more. And yet that call back in his ear somewhere says, I'm not going to give up the generosity God has taught me, even though it doesn't seem to be working too well at this point. Even as I say that to you, I think it's a hard road. In fact, it's not even possible unless you have the love of God in your heart. And that gets worked pretty hard sometimes. But yet, that's kind of where that picture is. So we have that. And I believe somewhere along the line, people who didn't like the church or were angry with the church, people who didn't believe in God, got out that information that the church was not very welcoming, sort of a closed corporation. You only wanted a few people here. And that really wasn't true. I'm sure it's happened. We're all human beings. And we fall short of God's word. We say that every Sunday, asking for God's help and forgiveness, and it's there. So we move forward. And I think the church isn't that way. It's out there opening and welcoming. We say our synod's meeting today, they're going to talk about the United Church of Christ, extravagant welcome. That always sounds good, and that's what the call is. But our generosity gets a little smaller. We're being pushed to be a little more generous in spirit and attitude. And as I say, not easy, and it works in many different ways. So, and the world is tough. I think we keep saying everybody's welcome. I don't know if they believe it, so you have to keep saying it's true. We're welcome people in the name of our Lord Jesus. So we have that picture before us. I'm going to move on just a little to that whole thing of this extravagant welcome. I used to say I don't like that word. This is welcome study, but asking us to move a little bit forward. When you come into our state and says, welcome to Pennsylvania. Makes you feel like, you're welcome. I couldn't say stay out. Usually it says, welcome to Pennsylvania. Speed limit is, that's in New York, it's there anyway. And we know the struggles with you there. I read a story, I'm not sure, you always wonder about these accounts. But a man was at a shopping center in Minnesota wearing a t-shirt that said, I follow Jesus. And he was stopped by one of the security people and said, that's annoying to people. You'll have to change that. But well, I can go, but no, I can buy something. No, we want you to put on inside out or leave. So he left. Now I'm not sure, I hope that's not true, but I'm afraid that might very well be the thing. And he said, there's all other annoying things on t-shirts too, but wouldn't that be, that's kind of that picture. So your generosity kind of starts going in there a little bit. We have, Jesus talks about families. We had a young Jewish girl in our school who later married a Christian man. And even without leaving the Jewish faith, her father said, you're not welcome at home. That's such a sad thing to think that faith to build together pulls people apart. We've all heard things such as that. And I always give you one of my obscure songs from the, now this is from the 1960s, so I move it up. But it's a sad song. It says, the basic line is, I'm standing on the welcome mat, but the welcome's growing thin. With my long lost soul, I'm just a long lost soul, may I come in. And the song ends. Never says yes, no, whatever. Well, I give you a little more definite one. Talk about families that don't get together. Mother-in-law and daughter-in-law have been feuding for years. And so the mother-in-law shows up at the door one day, and the younger woman answers the door and says, oh, hello, how long do you plan to stay? Leading question. And she very kindly says, I plan to stay as long as I'm welcome here. Oh, you're not even going to stay for coffee, she said. That's not welcome at all. We never had this. A little better welcome comes from was the governor of Oregon in the 1970s. On CBS television, he said, come and visit our wonderful state of Oregon. This is a state of excitement. But please don't plan to come and live here. So that's sort of a come and visit, but they don't want just everybody. We've gone from a no welcome to a qualified welcome, to this extravagant welcome which our God gives to us. As servants, as followers of God, we have the opportunity to follow and to live in God's word and in his world. So we have that beautiful picture which is set before us. So this is the good land we're singing about. Thank God for the land in which we live. And with all the clamor and disappointments and questions and distractions, we're still free to serve our God, to rejoice in that freedom which we have, and let God's generous spirit abide in us for today and for all the tomorrows that God will give to us. Using the Apostles' Creed. Let us confess our faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us unite our hearts in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, what a joy that is for us to address you as our Heavenly Father. We come before you to praise you this day for the wonder of your word among us, for the call of Christ, for new life in Christ our Lord and our Savior. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. We give you many heartfelt thanks for your gracious and your generous love shown to us through Christ our Lord. We thank you for that love which helps us day by day to live in a sense of assurance and also to live with a spirit of joy in our hearts because we know your presence and the living presence of our Savior. Praise you for the opportunity we have of prayer. We come before you with our praises and our prayers and our petitions. We'd like to remember before you our family and friends. We offer our thanksgiving to so many people who touch our lives and bless us day by day. We would like to remember in prayer those we think of in special need today. We remember Dr. Bohan today and remember Nancy before you and also in their time of special need there, we would pray and lift our hearts in prayer to them. We thank you, Lord, for your ongoing life-giving word through Christ our Lord. We praise you in his name, and we pray that you would accept our thanksgiving as we pray in the name of Christ. Amen. Please be seated. gifts also. We thank you to bless our lives in many directions. May these gifts also bless others. May send before, sending forth the good news of Christ, as we pray in his holy name. Amen. Of Holy Communion and follow there. God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to God most high.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
Gracious God, we give you thanks for the gift of Jesus, our Savior. In obedience to you, he suffered on the cross and was raised from the dead and delivered us from sin and death. With your people of faith, in all times, we praise you with joy.
Holy God, we come to your table to be fed the true bread of eternal life. With all the saints on heaven and earth, we glorify you.
Supper has been celebrated through many years as we follow Christ's word. Especially interesting today, we talk about God's generous call to us to live in a generous spirit. How generous is our Lord? Open that table to all people who come in faith, rejoicing in Him. So we give praise to God for the wonder of that word which is there and what we celebrate this day. In which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This as oft as you do it in remembrance of me." And after the same manner also, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This as oft as you drink it, do it in remembrance of me." Pray, O God, you will bless both us and these elements of the bread and the cup, that they speak to us of the wonder of Christ's life and death and resurrection, and that we share in that wondrous truth. Bless our churches, we pray, and guide us as we celebrate, as we pray in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. Holy, holy, holy God, in love and majesty, the whole universe speaks of your glory. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest. We remember that night we've spoken of, the night of betrayal and desertion, on the eve of death, Jesus gathered his disciples for the feast of the Passover. And as we spoke, he took bread after giving thanks for it and said, "This is my body which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the cup, he said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of our faith. According to invite and participate in our Holy Communion, those who seek to honor the life of Jesus among us, confess our faith and to rejoice in his saving truth. Ask our ushers to come forward then and make us feel fairly. The bread which we break is to us the communion of the body of Christ. Take it. Savior, bless, preserve, and keep you. Amen. Peace. all-powerful God.
By granting us the presence of Christ, strengthen our faith, increase our love for one another, and send us forth into the world in courage and peace, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the God the Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Closing hymn is Jesus Calls Us to Worship, 207.